النكاح من سنتي، ما قال النبي هو الصحيح، نكاح مبارك مبارك.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome, brothers and sisters, to another episode in the series titled Marriage and Divorce. With myself here is our Sheikh Haitham al-Haddad, who is currently based in the UK and is on the board of the Sharia Council of Britain. He's also the founding member of the website www.islam21c.com. In this episode, we shall aim to continue discussing the issue of obstacles when it comes to the procedure of marriage. Assalamu alaikum, Sheikh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
We ended the last episode talking about the Muslims and non-Muslims, and also we then cover the topic to do with non-practicing Muslims. That leads us to the topic of the kafa'a. Is there anything that you'd like to say about that?
Yes, bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, alhamdulillah wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillah. You know the issue of kafa'a, let me translate it. What does it mean? It is known in Arabic as kafa'a. Kafa means suitability or maybe similarity, okay, between the two sides.
So is this different to compatibility?
Yeah, it is totally different from compatibility. Kafa means, is this person of a similar status of this person? Kufa. Kufa means, is he suitable to get married to this person in terms of their status? The status can be social status, financial status, tribal status, okay, deen status, practicing, non-practicing, and so on. So this is the discussion. There is a lot of discussion between the scholars regarding this issue of status. Most of the scholars said that status in Islam, although it is considered, but it is not a reason to stop marriage. This is the conclusion. They have different ways of looking at it. For example, can the Arab marry a non-Arab? Can the non-Arab marry an Arab? A rich person and a non-rich person. A person from a certain tribe marry a person from another tribe or from no tribe. They have a lot of discussion. And the conclusion is, they said that these things can be taken into consideration, but they cannot be a reason to stop the marriage or to invalidate the marriage.
So it's not considered a Shari'i reason to stop the marriage going ahead?
Yes. However, in order to be realistic in this matter, let us go to the procedure again. This brother, he's interested in marrying this sister. He finds her suitable. He proposed to her. They accepted him. This is the key thing. They accepted him, whether he is rich, poor, from same social status, from same social background, educational background, from the same tribe, Arab, non-Arab, they accepted him. So if they accepted him, he accepted her, that is the key issue. End of the story. However, some scholars discuss the issue of this suitability or kafa'a, called kafa'a, if it happened that the person deceived them, yeah? And he said that his social status is this, his background is this, his tribe is this. And then they found that he is lower than that. He's not rich, he's not well-educated, he doesn't have this background, his family is not a well-respected family. You know, these things, although some people say, well, the deen is the most important thing. It is true that the deen is the most important thing, but these things have to be taken into consideration because sometimes they affect the suitability, the compatibility as well. This is the issue of kafa'a.
My next question is to do with, it might still be an obstacle, to do with the medical checks. Is this needed in Islam? Is this something that families can request, for example?
Yeah, now, what do we mean by medical checks? You know, now they discovered that there are some genetic problems and some compatibility issue. Person A might be a perfect person, person B might be a perfect person, But A is not suitable for B. It might be suitable for C. It might be suitable for D. Again, B might not be suitable for A, although she's perfect and he's perfect. She might be suitable to person X or Y or Z. So now, because of this, and it has been proven and it has been seen that some children are born with major disability problems. Yeah, major disability problems. Then the scholars, the contemporary scholars, started to discuss this issue. Do we have to have a medical check or not? Yeah, in order to avoid genetic problems inherited by the children. The scholars have two views, the contemporary scholars. Some contemporary scholars, they say we don't need it because it was not mentioned in the Quran and Sunnah. It was not mentioned in the Quran and Sunnah, but there is no indication for it. The other scholars said, no, in Quran and Sunnah, لا ضرر ولا ضرار. Don't harm others and don't reciprocate harm. Okay? Don't inquire harm. And this will lead to harm for the children. So this is the matter of discussion. Of course, I cannot conclude any direction, but it seems that the contemporary scholars go for the direction that if there is a high possibility of disabled children who are going to suffer and the society is going to suffer, the parents are going to suffer, then they should have this medically checked. And if it has been proven that they are not suitable medically, okay, for each other, then they should not do it. Now, you know, some Muslim countries, they imposed it, that you cannot marry any lady before having the medical check and having a medical certificate that you are suitable to get married to her.
Okay, but is this something that, for example, in the West, is this something that someone should look to do?
Well, again, it is very difficult for me to conclude, okay? It is very difficult for me to conclude. Because, you know, on the other side, the scholars who said, we don't need it, they say, have tawakkul, yeah? Put your trust in Allah. And they also said that if you have disabled children, this is rahmah from Allah, mercy from Allah, for them, for you, for the society. Because we are not like the kuffar or the disbelievers. When we see disabled children, we remember the greatness of Allah. We become more merciful to them. We look after them more. And this reminds us of the shortcomings of this dunya. And the parents will get reward. Yeah? And that's why, you know, we might come to this mas'ala, but I'll mention it, this issue. You know, this issue of aborting disabled children. Yeah, having abortion for disabled children. Now, you know, this is one of the most frequent questions that are asked. Yeah, and one of the very common questions that people do ask me. And I always say to them that if the fetus reached the age of 120 days, it means that now he is a living being. The ruh has been blown. Because the Prophet ﷺ said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَجْمَعُ خَلْقَ أَحَدِكُمْ فِي بَطْنِ أُمِّهِ أَرْبَعِينَ يَوْمًا عَلَقًا, that the creation goes through the stages. As the Prophet ﷺ said, that Allah جل وعلا creates the person 40 days as a nutfa, then 40 other days as alaqa, yes, connected, attached, and 40 other days chewed, يعني مضغة. مضغة means chewed flesh. Okay, and then the ruh is blown. So 40, 40, 40, this is 120, then the ruh is blown. Okay, 120, then the ruh is blown, which means that 120 plus, it is a human being, okay, breathing, etc., etc. After that, it is not allowed under any circumstance to have abortion because of the disability of the child. Now, many Western non-Muslim doctors, they don't understand this. They say, just get rid of it. Yeah. And we say that it is a kind of murder. Not full murder, but it is a form of murder from an Islamic perspective. So we are different from them with regards to the value of life.
Mm. Even from that such an early age?
Yes, yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Brothers and sisters, please come back and join us where we shall continue this discussion along the lines of obstacles when it comes to the procedure of marriage and the nikah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
A friendly message by Dr. Zakir, mother of all evils.
According to the World Health Organization, every year, millions of people die due to the consumption of alcohol. My colleagues, the medical doctors, nowadays say that alcoholism is a disease. Therefore, we have to be sympathetic towards a sick alcoholic person. If alcoholism is indeed a disease, then it is the only disease that is sold in bottles. It is the only disease that is advertised in the newspapers, in the magazines, on radio broadcast stations, on television satellite channels. It is the only disease that has outlets licensed to legally spread it. It gets a revenue for the government. It is the only disease that causes violent deaths on the highways. It destroys family life and increases crime. It is the only disease that has no germs or viral cause. But our Creator, the Almighty, says in His last testament, the glorious Quran, in Surah Maidah, chapter number 5, verse number 90, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, O you who believe, innamal khamru wal maisuru, most certainly intoxicants and gambling, wal ansabu wal azlam, dedication of stones, divination by arrows, rijsum min amali shaitan, these are an abomination of Satan's handiwork. Fajtanibuhu lallakum tuflihun, abstain from such abomination that you may prosper. Alcoholism is not a disease, it is Satan's handiwork. Abstain from it that you may prosper.
East TV, the solution for humanity.
Most countries of the world ban bullying. They fight it in their schools and universities. A lot of us are being bullied differently every single day. Some come up to us and say, do this, while others say, don't you dare. Some say this is halal, halal, while others say, nope, this is haram. Haram. Are you confused? Are you confused? Do you feel lost? Join me in Umdatul Ahkam, where, with the grace of Allah, we will learn the proper knowledge from the Quran and from the Sunnah, which would help stop this kind of bullying.
Join Asim Al-Hakim in Umdatul Ahkam, next on Peace TV.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome back, brothers and sisters, to this second part of the episode where we shall continue the discussion on the obstacles of what might invalidate the nikah. Assalamu alaikum, Shaykh.
Wa alaikum assalam.
We were talking about the medical conditions and whether the checks should or can be carried out. I wanted to continue this in terms of the fertility. Is this something that can be checked also?
Bismillah wa salatu wa salam ala Rasulillah. See, in terms of compatibility or suitability or kafa'a and the contemporary issues, there are many, and it is very difficult for me as a person to conclude a particular opinion, because now fiqh councils are studying these issues. And some scholars say we should go for it, some other scholars say we should not go for it, etc. So the disagreement is there. Again, this issue of fertility, scholars, contemporary scholars, differed over it. Some scholars said, no, it is an important check that has to be made, because fertility is one of the main aims of nikah. Mm-hmm. And that's why we spend good time to discuss the aims of nikah, because once we understand the aims of nikah, this will help us to understand many things related to marriage. One of the main aims of marriage is to what?
To increase the ummah.
To increase the ummah of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, to produce children who will be righteous people, etc., etc. And we quoted hadith Ma'qil ibn Yasar. When a man wanted to marry a lady and she was not fertile, she doesn't conceive, and the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said no. Then again, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said no. Then the third time, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said no. تَزَوَّجُ الْوَدُودُ الْوَلُودُ Marry the wadud, the loving lady, and the walud means the one that conceives and gives children, even not just conceives one child. Walud means many. This is her nature. She is very fertile. This is the point. She is fertile. So it is an issue. It is a real issue. From both sides.
Of course.
Whether the lady or the man. So for example, if the man is not fertile, yeah, has no ability, this is other than impotence. Mm-hmm. No. This is the case where the man cannot produce children or the lady cannot conceive children. What will be the case? By the way, if the man knows that he cannot produce children, then he must say this.
This was going to be my next question.
He must say this. If he doesn't say this, and they found out that he cannot produce children, the marriage will be that they have the right to go to the judge to invalidate the marriage based on this. Because this is one of the aims of nikah.
But this is only if they previously knew, before the nikah was done, that if they knew they were infertile.
No, both cases, both. For example, if the man says, Wallahi, I don't know. I just knew now. They got married the first year, second year, third year, fourth year, no pregnancy. You know, people will start asking them. Yeah? Especially in certain cultures, they normally accuse the lady. What's wrong with you? What's wrong? You are not fertile. And this is part of her femininity. You have femininity?
Yeah.
Okay.
Womanhood.
Yes, womanhood. That she cannot conceive. And they don't normally accuse the man. Anyway, so if it happened that they checked, both checked, and they found, or the man found that he cannot produce the children, then the wife has the right to go to the court to ask for marriage dissolution. And the judge must listen to her, because this is one of the main aims of marriage, and she's not finding it. Whether the husband knew and he cheated them, or he didn't know. He found now.
In both cases.
Both sides.
Both sides.
For example, I got married to a lady, then I found that she cannot conceive. I have the right to, not just to divorce, I have the right to go to the court to invalidate the marriage. And even I might get my full mahar back. Yeah? On the other side, if the lady found that the man, her husband, cannot produce children, again, she have the right to go to the court and to invalidate the marriage.
I think this is a very important point to get across to the audience.
Yes. Now, see, if the man doubts that he might be infertile, maybe because of his family, or he was involved in a car accident, or certain illnesses, or something like this, then in that case, before getting married, he has to check in order to what? To clarify his status to the lady.
Of course, like you said, this is more of a modern issue that has come up because fertility checks have not been around for that long, considering. Yep. SubhanAllah. On that note, Sheikh, I mean, I don't have any further questions in terms of the obstacles. Is there anything you want to add, or if not, maybe we can summarize?
No, I think these are the most important obstacles that we have mentioned. We mentioned, first of all, that both of them can marry each other in terms of mahramiyya. Yeah, they are not haram to marry each other. Mm-hmm. Then we mentioned the issue of the deen. Yeah. Then we mentioned the issue of kafa'a, suitability. And I think these are the main issues that normally discussed.
Yeah,
in terms of obstacles.
In that case, we can move possibly onto the second condition, which is going to be, is it acceptance?
Yeah, the second condition of a valid marriage, or the second condition for the marriage to be valid. Yes. acceptance.
So acceptance, I mean, what does that mean? The audience and myself might not understand necessarily what that is.
What do we mean by acceptance? See, the marriage is a contract. A contract means myself or the contractors, the parties, should have expressed their internal will to get into that contract. This is the overriding rule with regards to contracts in Islam in general. In other words, you cannot force someone to get into a contract that he or she does not want to get into it. And it means that if a contract happened without the clear will and irada, a clear will or a manifestation of a real will, a clear manifestation of his internal will to get into this contract, then that contract is invalid or might be invalid.
Okay, so this, for example, would the issue of forced marriage would come under this?
Yes, the issue of forced marriage will come under this. So before discussing the forced marriage, what do we mean by ijab wa qabul? In order to study ijab wa qabul, we have to study two things. The format of ijab and qabul, the format, and who is qualified to do the ijab and qabul. Who should do the ijab and qabul? Who should demonstrate the acceptance? Mm-hmm. Yeah? Or as the fuqaha said, the offer and the acceptance. Who should demonstrate that? Okay? So in terms of the format, the scholars discussed a number of issues. Does the format have to be in a specific word? Okay, or any word that leads to the meaning of marriage is acceptable. This is one thing. The other thing the scholars discussed, which is, does the format have to be in Arabic or it can be in English? They also said that does the format or the offer and acceptance have to be in the same meeting, the same sitting, or I can say, I want to marry your daughter, I am marrying your daughter, and the father, for whatever reason, or the daughter, for whatever reason, they said, in fact, now we need to think about something. And they left. And tomorrow, they said, got, done. Yeah? The daughter is married to you now. But tomorrow, I might have a change in my mind. Yeah? Saying, well, they started to think about me now. I don't want it. So they came to me and they said, done. The wife said, qabiltu. I accepted it. I will say, no, I didn't. Okay, I refused. I changed my mind. Yeah? Do they have to be on the same? And then the scholars discuss some contemporary methods of what? Of ijab and qabul. Yeah? Contemporary methods of ijab and qabul. Let us go to the first one, which is, do we have to stick to a certain language or not? Yeah? Do we have to stick to a certain language or not? The scholars have discussed this in length. Do we have to use the word zawajtuka, ankahtuka, mallaktuka? A lot of discussion. To cut it short, as Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala said, that any statement that leads to marriage, any statement that confirms that this person is marrying this person, and there is no confusion about it.
So both sides are on the same level, basically. Same
both sides understand that they are getting into a marriage. Yeah? Whether they use ankahtuka, zawajtuka, mallaktuka, or this leads to the second side of the story, which is, can it be in any language other than Arabic? I got married to you, or any other language. Yeah? Does that constitute a valid sigha, a valid format, or not? This is the discussion. Now, as I said, Sheikh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah said, any form that leads to marriage, then it is acceptable as a sigha for marriage, as a format for marriage, whether using the word ankahtuka, zawajtuka, mallaktuka, or any other Arabic word, or even any other non-Arabic word. However, we always say, just put yourself on the safe side and try to use some words that confirm that this is a marriage. This is an Islamic marriage. Yeah?
Difference.
This is an Islamic marriage, not the civil marriage. Yep.
Jazakallah khair, Sheikh. Unfortunately, we've run out of time, but we will definitely continue this discussion, inshallah. Brothers and sisters, please return to us in the next episode where we shall continue the discussion on the second condition that we have covered, which will be the acceptance when it comes to the nikah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
نكاح مبارك
مبارك
زواج مبارك
مبارك
النكاح من سنتي ما قال النبي هو الصحيح نكاح مبارك
مبارك
There is joy, there is happiness,
happiness.
In this union let there always be bliss Allah will bless your home with light Your heart with never-ending delight Two worlds today have now become one The road ahead is as bright as the sun Oh Allah Keep this merit so strong. In your hands does their future belong. Belong. Oh.